Ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon and welcome to the September 21st Public Affairs Forum. We have an absolutely marvelous program today. What we're going to do is we're going to take a look at the courts in our county. And I'll probably bug you in between times, but we'll have questions at about half an hour into this. But folks, let me just, without any further ado, take advantage of the opportunity to introduce. I'm not doing well today. I was attacked by a cup of coffee on my way here. And so anybody who sees all these spots on my shirt, just understand it was the coffee's fault, not mine. Anyway, without any more muttering, Judge Charles Bailey, the presiding judge of Washington Courts, is here for us, Washington County Courts, and here we are. Thank you.
Thank you all for having me and allowing me an opportunity to give you guys a little bit of feedback of what we're doing, not only in Washington County, but also statewide. A lot of the presentation I'm going to be going over is what we're doing statewide in the Oregon Judicial Department as well. So a couple things you have up there is, one, you've got the old jail. We've exceeded the black and white one there is the old jail. We've exceeded the capacity of that jail in Washington County at this time. On the other side there, any other University of Oregon graduates? Right, we have our other ones up there, right? I'm a double duck, very proud of that. So that's why I've got the fighting duck icon up there. All right, so kind of give you guys, this is going to be like one of those sort of,
just hold it.
All right, I'll hold it. Obviously, you all know what the three branches, this is a highly intelligent group of folks, you know what the three branches are. I think the reason why OJD is asked, this is up there to sort of remind everybody that we are one of the branches of government that seems to be forgotten from time to time. So we kind of get treated like the red-headed stepchild sometimes by our legislatures in the sense of funding for us. I say that tongue-in-cheek, that's a joke. So that's kind of why we have all three of them. Obviously, those are the three pillars of our government and what makes it so successful when each of those are equal branches. All right, so the Oregon Judicial Department, the purpose of the OJD is to administer justice in a fair and timely manner. The OJD values and visions, goals are those that are included there. One, of course, to ensure access to our court system. Two, to administer cases effectively and timely. We have that are produced by our Supreme Court Justice, Chief Justice Ballmer, our timely disposition sheets. Tells basically when a case is filed, here's when you should be averaging the resolution of that particular case. So we have timely disposition numbers that in Washington County we are very accurate on. In fact, we do a very good job. We usually exceed most of the dispositions that the Chief Justice has asked us to do. Other things we do is, of course, resolve disputes. Obviously, sometimes we have to put our striped shirts on when people can't resolve their cases themselves and make decisions for them. That's obviously the purpose of our court, to do so in a professional way. And then, of course, we build partnerships. That's one of the reasons we come out and speak to you good folks like you all, is to this kind of idea that everybody needs to be involved through this process. We need to build partnerships, not only with other folks that may be involved in other types of branches of government, but also the folks that are in our communities. And then, of course, maintain public trust and confidence. I think that's the key to really what we do, is that people aren't trusting what we're doing, don't believe in what we're doing. That kind of creates types of situations that we have seen over the last year or two in other areas in which folks are no longer trust what's going on in their systems, and so kind of can be a little bit of a chaos. So meeting these goals requires adequate access to justice for Oregonians, and sometimes I think what that means is we need proper funding for that to get that done. We'll talk a little bit about that. So the Oregon Judicial Department is less than 3% of the state's general budget. It's really a lower amount. I know the Chief Justice has been working on getting with the legislature, because it's difficult every single time to have to go back and pitch how important we are to the legislature and why we should be adequately funded, to come up with a better mechanism of how to just sort of make sure there's certain funds that are given to the judicial department without having to go back and tell them why we need them. And I know the Chief Justice is working on all those sort of things. Increasing the amount is passed through to others. A lot of our courthouses, including here in Washington County, are very old. And as a result of that, they are not earthquake proof. And so, for example, there was a big capital project, of course, that's going to be beginning, I don't know the time of it, but in Multnomah County, because the belief is if the earthquake occurs, everybody thinks it's going to happen sometime, that courthouse will come crumbling down. The idea for our courthouse is it's a good chance it'll come crumbling down. If it doesn't, there'll certainly be uninhabitable. That's kind of where we are. There are still parts of that are over 75 years old. And so it's a pretty old form. So a lot of the money that we end up having and getting through the budget is used for other court facilities. And of course, unfortunately, security has become a bigger issue. And so, for example, in Washington County, as a result of over the last 20 years, people taking in weapons and those kind of things, we have to have sort of booths at the front. We don't do any strip searches, so it's not quite like you have to get an airplane or anything like that. But certainly we have to make sure we maintain a good security so people feel safe to get the things done that they need to get done in our courthouse. Other things we're having to do with some of the money is to provide money to legal aid and to use other types of resources such as mediation to kind of help us, because the resources are limited, to help us resolve disputes. And so some of the money goes to those type of areas as well. Is it going to work better if I step up? I hate holding up to a mic. I'm a hands guy.
Either one will work. We just,
as long as I get close enough, that'll work. All right. I'm a hands guy. I talk with my hands a lot. And they tell attorneys not to do that. But that's kind of who I am and how I talk. And so it's a little bit tough. All right. Some of the other things that we do with the money, of course, is our trial court operations. Almost all, about 95, 96% of OJB budget goes to salaries and how we compensate people. It really is people intensive business, and a large, like I say, percentage of that money goes to paying people and compensating people for the services that they do. Now, OJD collected over $277 million in 2011-2013. That money went into the general fund. Including in that is over $20 million that we've collected in restitution for victims. So that's a sizable amount. And I'm going to talk a little bit further about some things we're doing in Washington County that's actually improved our ability to get money from defendants for victims' compensation, our restitutions. So one of the things that we're doing is, of course, strong courts build strong communities. We know that, and that's why we're doing these type of outreach programs when I'm talking to good folks like you. And here's some of the reasons why. I know there's a lot of folks out there that have businesses in the community, and hopefully, for the most part, you guys never have to come see us to resolve those disputes. But there are certainly times in which that hasn't happened, and we do need the court and the access to the court to get those done. And of course, that's what we do. We enforce the rules of the marketplace, the contracts that you guys devise and come up with are some of the things that we have to then interpret and enforce when folks can't agree on what those contracts necessarily say or somebody doesn't live up to their end of that contract. We resolve disputes between and among businesses and consumers and debts. We do a large debt collection practices in Washington County. It's one of the largest between foreclosures, judicial foreclosures, because there hardly any non-judicial foreclosures anymore. In the last 15, 20 years, there was a lot of non-judicial foreclosures, but due to some of the changes in the law, almost every foreclosure now is judicially resolved. And as a result of that, we're doing a ton more of those types of cases. For example, I think it was in 2011 and or 2012, we went from having five foreclosure actions filed in one season to over 600 filed in the next year. So it was a huge change in the types of cases we saw, and those are some of the disputes that we're having to resolve. Other things we do is obviously foster public safety. We have several different courts that the purpose of those is for restraining orders or stalking orders, those sort of things. Restraining orders have to do with not only intimate partners, they also have to do with elder folks that are being taken advantage of. And so we have to be there to help save and to protect those kind of folks in our communities, because sometimes they don't necessarily have a lot of folks out there that are aware of what's going on and or who can protect them. And so that's kind of sometimes where we fall into for them. Some of the times we have to make decisions, as you well know, as Mr. Tyner knows, since he's our criminal defense attorney, we have to make decisions on putting folks in jail and or how we're going to utilize our prisons. And that's one of the things that we as judges kind of take a look at, that for the most part, if we're sending somebody to prison, it's kind of a failure. Because most folks that do go to prison have built up a criminal record before they go to prison. We don't normally send folks to prison right away, with the exception being, you know, somebody who perpetrates a sort of heinous crime on somebody, a very serious person crime on somebody. Those folks will likely go to prison on their first time out. But most folks have to build up a criminal history, which means we work with them on their probations, and we aren't successful in sending them to prison. We kind of look at that as a bit of a failure on our part in the system. All things we do is protect vulnerable citizens. I already talked a little bit about seniors, and guardians. Our probate court has been pretty active lately in regards to guardianships. Judge Cobb, and now Judge Irwin, who's taken over for Judge Cobb, who retired. And so they do a lot of guardianships to protect a lot of folks out there that are a little bit older and, again, are unable to protect their funds, or they just don't see necessarily because they're a trusting folk, and they don't realize that there are some bad people out there that have no problem taking advantage of that trust. And so those guardianships help to protect those seniors. Of course, kids in foster care is a big thing that we do. In fact, I wanted to chat with Judge Menchaca, who does our juvenile work, before I came in front of you all, to kind of get an idea from him where we are with our Department of Human Services and our placements. And one of the things concern that he had is actually in Washington County, we're really low on foster care placements. So the courts have become even more involved in really making sure where kids are going are good places, and making sure that we're really striving to get them in a placement first with a family member, and before we have to move them to some other place. For example, we're having to use Polk County, a lot of foster care folks in Polk County right now, because we just don't have the places here in Washington County. So that's kind of some of the things we do in building strong communities. This slide is all about really the idea of how the court is really a filter in what we do in our communities. And these are a lot of things that are coming in, you know, crimes and violations, and then how we have to dispose of those in the process and filtering through. Children at risk, we already talked a little bit about that, and making sure we have safe and stable homes. Civil and economic disputes, we need to make sure we get timely dispositions to those. Those can be extremely important in the sense of how people need to know what they're going to do with business and how they need to move forward. And they need to get that information sooner than later so they can know what they're going to need to do. And then, of course, in either abuse or domestic types of situations, again, especially in family law types of cases, really sometimes the kids are involved, need to have an answer. Where am I going to be staying? School's going to be starting up. Which family member are going to be at during this part of the week, and which family member are going to be at another part of the week? And so having timely disposition of those is extremely important. And those are a lot of things that we do within your courthouse that sometimes you don't recognize. A lot of times people look at our court system and say all they do is deal with criminals and stuff like that. It's not. It is so much more than that. And this is kind of the filter, kind of how to go through that. This is, again, kind of your system here in Oregon. We have 7 Supreme Court justices, with Thomas Palmer being the Chief Justice right now. We have now, I think it's 4 panels for court appeals. It is in effect. All 4 panels are up and going at this point in time. We have our tax court, and then of course we have our local court systems, Washington County, being what we call District 20 in the state, and that's kind of how the court system breaks down. So caseloads, over 541,000, basically 542,000 cases were filed in 2013. It's a big number, and it includes violations, but it gives you an idea of those are the number of cases that each of the 27 judicial districts in Oregon have to deal with. So it's a lot of cases that we have to deal with. And there's going to be a slide coming up that kind of goes over the workload of those cases and kind of how it breaks down. The key here in the last part there, it talks about, as I already talked a little bit about, foreclosure actions. Also as well, because of our housing boom that we had in the early 2000s, it led to, let's say, some not great building of homes. And as a result of that, we had a lot of very complex litigation cases dealing with construction defect. And all those are much more court intensive and much more time consuming of resources. For example, I've had, in the last 4 years, I've had two construction defect cases go to trial. One of those lasted for a month. So I was only involved in that one case for a month, and the other one took about almost 3 weeks to finish up. They take a lot of time. They're very complex. A lot of experts that have to come in and talk about the damage and the reasons why, and it takes a lot of time and effort. And that's what's important to kind of understand by that, and same thing with foreclosures. Before, somebody could basically do the non-judicial foreclosure. We weren't involved. We never saw the case. Now there's a lot more summary judgments that are being filed and things in which the court has to be active in and being part of, which means it takes up a lot more of our time. This is an idea of sort of breakdown. You can see violations. We'd love to see, you know, more violations, not necessarily, just sort of, as you can see, it's not as intense of a workload for us judges. We're hardly even involved when it comes to violations. If you get a violation, a lot of times you just send in your check with that and the judge makes a decision. Sometimes we reduce it, sometimes we don't even see it at all. And so that's, we're just not very involved in those. And then as you can see, as it comes to criminal cases, we're very involved, or obviously have to be involved. It's very, so much more intense as far as our involvement goes. The same thing with civil cases and family law cases. There's a much, much more greater involvement. And so if there are more of those cases being filed, of course, we're having to utilize more time in courtroom to resolve those disputes. OJ efforts to improve access. Here are some of the things that OJD has been doing that I think are really, really important. E-court is one of the bigger things. Every single county in Oregon as of January of 2017 will be online. It will all be live. We in Washington County were one of the last counties to go live. We go live in March of 16. So it's kind of the good and the bad. The good is we got to wait for everybody else to go through all the pitfalls of the new electronic system. The bad is we have to sort of accept everything that those folks have already done before us. We're not going to have a whole lot of input on any kind of changes within that process. But the beauty of the system is it's basically 24/7 access to people to get information and or to file any complaints, those kind of things. So that expands to some degree the access to justice. Even though we're not there currently, folks can still file things, which is great. Also means we don't have to have as much staff involved with giving them information because they have access to that information without our staff helping them. Online payments, I don't know why it took when I became a judge, I was like, we don't accept visas or anything like that for any payments. We just didn't have a system set up to do that, and we are now. And people can make payments online. So again, we're not having to have staff, you know, assist them in those payments, and folks aren't having to go through the process of waiting until our windows are open to pay and coming actually to the courthouse to pay, which is a benefit to those folks. They don't have to worry about those type of items. Also, we have a lot of forms that are online and that are going to help folks access to justice. If we can't give them legal advice, certainly the forms can help people to understand here the things you need to do in the process and what you need to go through it. And so that's the intelligent forms are all about. Safe courthouses, I already talked a little bit about upgrading for the facilities themselves, and of course, security is one of those things. We're always monitoring our, I don't know what it is, our electronic devices seem to break down too often, and we're looking at having to replace those, and again, it's an expense that we're gonna have to endure, but we need to make sure we do that to make sure everybody feels safe when they come into the courthouse, and especially, unfortunately, domestic, you know, family law area, that's one of those areas in which there can be a lot of tension, and I wanna make sure everybody feels safe, that they have an opportunity to place, resolve those disputes in a professional way. Fee waiver deferral process, again, so those ideas, access to justice. We don't want folks to feel that they can't get access to justice because they can't afford to pay for it. And so we have expanded, the Chief Justice has expanded those folks that are eligible for waivers or deferrals of payments, and so make sure everybody's getting access to the court system. We also have, and in fact, we have one of, I think, the best in the state. For example, we have a family law self-help that people can come in there, they can get forms, we can kind of help them, again, what they need to do to fill out those forms. And so it's really a great process in which a lot of folks that are getting a divorce can really do it very simple, very cheap, not have to get attorneys or anything like that, because, you know, you get attorneys, it just sort of mucks up the situation, right? I'm just kidding, I'm turning myself. But it just does help those folks that the process is already difficult and they don't have to worry about hiring attorneys and paying for those attorneys. If it's a very simple divorce, they can do that and they have access to those folks that help them through that process. This was kind of redundant, but it was a slide that was on there. But I wanted to talk about the docket management, the best practices in all types of cases. Those practices are, we're doing more continuing legal education courses in those areas. We're having more training from OJD in those areas. And so it's really, really been helpful to the judges to kind of understand that process and to help folks through that process. One of the things I'm very proud of in Washington County, other than the Veterans Court, we don't have them. We just didn't see the need for the Veterans Court. We're not getting a whole lot of veterans coming back and having, you know, great need to have a separate Veterans Court. But everything else that's on there, we have. We have one of the best mental health courts that was started by Judge Hernandez, who's now a federal judge. And we have one of the most nationally recognized drug courts in Judge Cole when he's done with that program. We have a very active DUII court. In fact, we've expanded that. We've been able to go to Bob Herman, who's our DA, and ask him to expand the types of cases that are eligible for diversion, which has helped process cases through the system much, much quicker. And again, it gives that person that same opportunity that having the DUII diverted, not having a record for that, they may have had a reckless drive case that was also pending, they can have that diverted as well. So when they get done, they do everything they're supposed to do, they have essentially no record of that, which is, you know, the way it should be. If somebody does the right things in a timely fashion, they ought to be able to walk away and not necessarily have a record for that. And so we have a very good court for doing that. We also have what's called early case resolution. I'll get into a little bit of details about that. It's an idea of recognizing that some folks may actually want to plead guilty sooner than the old system was allowing it to take place. They wanted to accept responsibility for what they did, and it allows for an earlier resolution of cases. So Washington County has a lot of specialty courts, and I think we do it in a very, very good manner and highly efficient manner, allowing for earlier dispositions of types of cases, and for the understanding that, like, for example, mental health court, those folks need a more intense sort of supervision, if you will. And the more we're involved, the more we're just chatting with those people, the better they're doing on probation. On the debt collection, I think there's also a move now to do a lot of our phone system, but we have centralized, again, that online debt collection. We're also looking at having a single center to do a lot of the phone calls that come into the courts. What we know is, I think it's for every phone call that comes in, it takes between 1 and 5 minutes for the staff person to get re-engaged in whatever they were doing before. Just the idea that you have to answer the phone, you move away from whatever your thought process was, you answer the question, and then you go, it takes you a little bit of time to get back into where you were at. And so the idea is, if you have a centralized phone system, folks were calling in and sort of saying, when is my court appearance? There could be a folk, you know, a person in Salem just saying, looking it up on the computer and saying, here's when your next court appearance is, and not having to take our staff people and take them away from the things that they're doing. So that's a push as well to make things far more efficient. In Washington County, I want to kind of give you an idea of some things we've done in Washington County. The early case resolution is one of those that I'm very proud of. I was in the early stages of that program, and it had some unintended consequences that were fantastic. For example, those of us who are parents know that you don't wait months when your kid has that transgression to, you know, give them a consequence for that action. You usually very quickly tell them what they did was wrong and give them the consequence, the idea being that they're going to change whatever they're doing and not necessarily do that again, or at least they understand it's going to be a quick consequence if they do it again. And what we found was in early case resolution, we had a lot of folks that were coming to court, who were wanting to accept responsibility, but we didn't have an avenue to get it done. The way the process was set up, you showed up for your arraignment, there wasn't an attorney there to help you in arraignment. And then you had a next court appearance, and it may not take care of there, because at that point in time, it could have been that your attorney just got appointed. Your attorney didn't have all the discovery, all the information, the plea offer from the DA's office. And so therefore, it took another month or two for the next court appearance before you would finally say, I'm guilty, which you wanted to do all along, accept responsibility, and move on doing your probation. So with early case resolution, of all those cases that we identified, and it's a long list of cases that are eligible for early case resolution, what we have is essentially 70 to 75% of those cases that are eligible resolve within 30 days of the time in which the person has committed the crime. So it's a really quick recognition of it. The unintended consequence that we didn't know about that I was talking about is defendants do better on probation, on average, by having entered in the ECR program because there's an early recognition of what they did was wrong. And therefore, they move forward in doing the right things on probation. One of those unintended consequences we didn't realize. When we stepped back and we thought about it, we're like, yeah, duh, that makes sense. And so that's one of those great things that are happening. We also started a process called re-engineering a couple of years back in Washington County. We have 14 judges in Washington County. Despite being the second largest population in the state, just to kind of give you an idea, the county to the east of us has 38 judges, and they have at least 15 pro tem judges. We have one pro tem, 14 judges, and yet that county to the east of us is only slightly more than a quarter bigger than us. Moreover, over the next 15 to 30 years, the idea is we'll probably move past Multnomah County by 2050 in our population. We have the area to grow. And so obviously the pressure on the courts is immense. Multnomah County has one judge for every 21,000 residents. We have one judge for every 40,000 residents here in our county. I'm hoping our legislature will recognize that and start to do it. We had a lot of good push from folks on the outside world to get pressure on the legislature to get the judge this last session. Politics, unfortunately, intervened. It didn't happen, but hopefully going forward, we're gonna get at least one. I'm hoping sort of about three judges in the next decade to really help out. Understanding we can't necessarily wait. We started this re-engineering process. Re-engineering process regarding the criminals, we looked at everything. We looked at the civil side, we looked at the criminal side, we looked at family, probate, we looked at the entire court system. We said, are we utilizing everything that we have efficiently? Are there things we can do better? And the good of the process was we involved the National Center for State Courts, which is a widely renowned statewide who collects data from all the states and all the different judicial districts around the entire nation, and they gave us feedback and information. And one of the things they told us was, you're doing things really well for the most part. You guys are really doing a very good job. We're only having 14 judges, and what you guys are accomplishing is pretty amazing. Secondly, they told us there are some things you could do a whole lot better. And it was good. And so what it did is it brought the judges together, and we collaboratively then worked to change some of the processes in which we do. And one of those big ones has been the criminal system. We are now much more engaged in our criminal cases and making sure that the cases are moving along in a timely fashion. We weren't necessarily as engaged before. It was kind of, here's your hearing, do you want to accept the offer? If you don't, we have a trial for you. And we found that in our county, we were having, for every 100 felony cases filed, we were having 6 trials, which doesn't seem like that much, except that other counties around us were having 2 or 3. The number one drain on our judicial resources is trials. They just take time to notch to resolve a dispute. And so it was one of the things we looked at, well, why? Why is that number so high? Or is everybody around us? The national average was 3. Why are we double the national average? Why are we 3 times Multnomah County? Why are we 3 times Clackamas? What are we doing differently And so we took a good, strong look at that. One of the things we determined was we were not actively engaged and involved in those cases and making sure discovery was done in a timely fashion. Making sure plea offers were giving out in a timely fashion. Having discussions with the litigants and is there anything we can do to help this case move this case along? Are there simple things that you need resolved from the court that might help a plea agreement take place? Those kind of things and being more actively involved. And what we've learned, we started this in March, now what we've learned is in the first 6 months of this program, we have already dropped dramatically the number of trials. And so it's already been proven successful. And although we're more actively involved up front, we're actually saving a tremendous amount of time by not having judges involved in trials. The benefit of that whole process is for those folks who could care less, which I guess you guys are folks that, except for maybe Mr. Tyner, could care less about the criminal side of things because you guys don't come see us for those sort of things, right? Is it also will give us an opportunity to take a look at civil cases. When I started I was a chief civil judge starting in 2011. When I first got started as a chief civil judge, one of the things I asked of our presiding judge was, we are not giving enough resources to the civil folks, the people that do have civil actions. We need to have more involvement with the courts in those situations. We had, I think in, it was 2009, we had three trials. That's it, three civil trials. And in 2010, I think it was five. And so we said we needed a commitment to these folks to make sure we get them to trial. They were ready for trial, they were geared up for trial, they were paying for witness fees, experts and everything. We just had to reset and reset and reset them. And so the joke was, you never get trial in Washington County, so why be prepared? And it was a very cost issue to those folks who do civil work. It was huge. And so I have a lot of friends who did civil cases. That was the thing they're telling me, and I asked for Judge Thompson to need a commitment, and she did. And the number of trials went from, I think it was 5 or 6 to 30 in the next year. We started moving those cases, and then as the chief civil judge, I started being more active in those cases. This engineering process on the criminal side, because by statute, the criminal cases generally take precedence over civil and over family law, will give us more opportunity to use our resources towards civil cases and towards family law cases, which I think is the beauty of what we're doing, and hopefully will be the ultimate success, is we'll take the resources that we have and gear them towards those other types of cases. We also came up with what we call a criminal white paper. I don't know why we call it a white paper, other than it's probably on white paper, that's what we call it. And what it has done, again, it was, there was past where the bench wasn't necessarily as collaborative with each other. They didn't have to be because there was more resources out there. But what we realized was if we all talked about to each other, we said, this is what we are all willing to agree that we will do to resolve a case or to how we would handle the case. And we published that information to people so that they knew. Yeah, in this type of a case, for example, on a first-time DUI, if a person accepts responsibility and pleads guilty, it's going to be 2 days of jail, which is required by statute, or 80 hours of community service work, their choice. We all said, yeah, we're all good with that. We'll agree to that. And then we did the same thing. We did the same thing for second-time, third-time DUIs. And we don't have to really deal with much more than that because now it's a felony when it's the fourth and beyond. And so those are statutory time requirements for folks in those situations. Other types of cases, we got together and we agreed on, and we published that information, and that has also led to people having certainty in the system. And by having certainty in the system, they have, again, resolved their cases earlier, because we've also told them on the flip side, if you go to trial, we don't know what's going to happen. It's going to be up to the judges to decide. It may be better than the plea offer that was given to you by the state. It may be worse than the offer that was given to you. We're not going to penalize you for going to trial. No way. But you don't know. And so it's uncertainty. And so that is having certainty, sort of the bird in the hand is better than two in the bush. All right, bird hunters out there. All right. And so that's worked really, really well. And the folks have accepted that. They know what's going to happen. We've been consistent in doing that together as a group. The judges have got together, published that white paper, and it's been really successful so far. Again, benefits the civil cases and family law cases, as I've already talked about, hopefully will give us an opportunity to get more resources that we're currently spending on criminal cases to those other areas in which we need to be involved in. Future issues and challenges, stable resources, as I talked about, Chief Justice trying to work with the legislature to come up with a formula in which to fund. We're not constantly having to come back and worry about the politics that is involved in schools, DHS, and fighting with them. They have their reasons for needing their money. We shouldn't have to fight with them and tell them why we're better, why we need more of those kind of things. And so trying to come up with a stable resource fund. Continue to work on efficiencies in the core processes, those things that I have already talked about. Improve access to justice regarding languages. I was really surprised. We had a current sort of folks take a look at as far as injured defense, and what I didn't realize, well, I should have, is we are actually the most diverse county in Oregon. And it's by a variety of things, whether it be a race, ethnicity, whether it be a socioeconomic, we have the highest, because we have the highest educated county. We have a lot of educated people that live in our county. I'm sure it's the intelligent most folks, right? And all those good folks. We have one of the highest. And we also have one of the diverse in the sense of you, everybody knows you can drive. I just did it. I just drove from the courthouse, went the back roads, Farmington, beautiful country out there. And you're right back into the great city of Beaverton. This is where I live, so I love the city. And so it's amazing how we have that diversity in the farming and agriculture and wine and also our cities. And so we're just one of the most diverse counties out there. So in regards to language, that means we have to have a very diverse interpreters. I did it recently, I think it was about 6 months ago, I had a murder trial. And we had to have two Truckees interpreters, and it was almost like to go back and realize that was a Pacific island, and okay, that's what that was all about. And it was a lot of expense because it was a longer murder trial, take a little bit longer, and having two of them always, because one has to interpret and one rests, and then just kind of the way it works. And it was very expensive, but it's what has to happen, and so that's one of those things that's going to cost, and we have to continue to worry about. We're talking about court facilities. I've already given you my pitch regarding judges in Washington County and why I'm hoping to grow those numbers in the next 3 to 5 years. Again, this one here is just kind of a reminder of everything that we do, the filter that is the courthouse, your courthouse, so I'm not going to go into detail about that. And then a couple quotes for you. One, I always think Orson Welles is a genius, his Rosebud and all those, I just think he's an absolute genius. Anyways, one of the quotes he has is, nobody gets justice, people only get good luck or bad luck. That's kind of funny, because sometimes that's how people feel when they leave, right? It's like, I didn't win here, that was bad luck or whatever it may be. I also think that Martin Luther King does a very good job of really ultimately what we have in the judges here in our county. We don't do this for the money. We are the 48th lowest paid judges in the nation. Judges here in Washington County and elsewhere in the state don't do it for the money. We do it because of these sort of reasons. It says human progress is neither automatic nor inevitable. Every step toward the goal, and I've underlined that, not necessarily me. I don't know if Martin Luther King, when he said it, put emphasis on that particular word. I did. I put that emphasis there because I always think it's a goal. Whether we get there or not, it's going to be up to those people to decide, but it's the goal that we should be trying to achieve. Every step toward the goal of justice requires sacrifice, suffering, and struggle, the tireless exertions and passionate concerns of dedicated individuals. And that's what I think we do have in Washington County with our judges here in Washington County. That's it.
Thank you very much, Judge Bailey. That was a tremendous amount of information there and very well presented. One of the highlights in the information for me was noting that the courts are able to accept electronic payments. I mean, I think that's convenient for everybody, but it's a great segue for me to remind folks who want to donate to the forum or who haven't paid up their membership that we too take memberships and donations online. And in order to ask questions, and I see the questioners are lining up, one must be a paid-up member of the forum. It's a privilege of membership. Again, we are starting questions. Our first questioner is right there. Go ahead, Bill.
My name is Bill Kroger. I'm a forum member. Thank you for coming in today. That was a good presentation. I enjoyed it. And I'm not surprised that Orson Welles said that. Recently, a county clerk in Kentucky has been in the news about not enforcing the new law about gays getting married. I'm just kind of wondering what your personal thought is about enforcing laws that you may not approve of, or your people doing that, and if there's any issues in the county that involve that kind of thing.
I'm only going to speak for myself, because I think all the other judges are going to have to speak for themselves and how they kind of approach it. For me, when the district court judge made the decision, it was really fairly easy for me, the decision that was made. I believe my job is to follow the law. And it's not my job to decide what the law is necessarily, unless I'm interpreting a thing. Statute. And for me, in that situation, it wasn't my job. It was that district court judge to make that decision as to interpret the laws, and including our Constitution. If I think the law is wrong, there's a process for changing that particular law. And for me, it was an easy decision. For a variety of reasons, either my faith. My faith says there's a good person up above who makes decisions as to whether they're right and wrong here on this earth. It's not for me to make those kind of decisions, and I'm a fairly devout believer in that sort of faith. It's not my job to judge what's in their hearts. My job is to follow the law. I have performed several different weddings in which folks were gay and wanted to be involved in that union and go through the marriage process. If the state decides to be involved, I don't know if the state should be involved in the marriage. I don't know if we should. Quite frankly, my belief is I don't think we should. But we are, and if we are, then we need to follow the laws and we need to perform those services. Yeah.
Thank you, Your Honor. I feel that kind of hit on something that affects me when you say you believe in the Supreme Being. I'm an atheist, and I wonder how you approach atheists when they come to court.
I don't approach them at all. That's a joke. What I mean by that is our religion does and should not be involved in decisions that we make. Our decisions are based on the law, the facts of what's presented in front of us, and only that. Whether somebody believes in a certain religion or doesn't believe in a certain religion or doesn't believe in religion altogether should make and has never even, quite frankly, I've never had the issue really come up in any decision that I had made. Maybe that's because I wouldn't allow it to take place and I wouldn't accept it to take place in my courtroom. That doesn't mean that judges, our morals may not be sharpened or changed or curbed as a result of our faith and our beliefs. But that doesn't necessarily mean that somebody doesn't believe in a higher being, doesn't have those same morals or those same ideas of what's right and what's wrong. It just means maybe it comes from a different place.
The rule of law and honesty is the best policy.
I honestly believe that sometimes our morals are just core, are at our core. We have inherently an idea of what's right and what's wrong. And so sometimes it can come from the core, sometimes it may come from our beliefs and what our belief system is.
Thank you.
Yep.
Hi, Phil Nelson, part member, retired lawyer, didn't do much criminal practice. But we appear in the United States to be fixated upon the incarceration system as a cure for social ills. And I hear that about 1 out of 10 blacks, for instance, are in jail. And 60% of the folks in jail are either black or Latino. And I'm wondering what the situation may be in Washington County in terms of ethnic and racial demographics and incarceration. And again, if there's anything the judiciary has been paying attention to in this regard, since it appears to be a very severe and serious social issue. Thank you.
So for me, it's a little harder. So I was raised in a military family. Dad was a career Army guy. He was a two-time Vietnam vet. And I was raised around people of all colors. And I also was in the military myself, which I think is probably the most diverse organization historically of there is out there. And I say that because I know people, this is like politically correct to say it, but people hate to hear it. I've continued to be raised. I raised my kids in this community. They go to a law high school in or Mountain View, which I think is one of the most diverse high schools in our area. And I raised them as I was raised to be colorblind. The color has nothing to do with how we should be approaching things. That doesn't mean we don't, our diets aren't, we're taking a look at different ethnicities and saying there's some good stuff out there, we ought to be having that part. But for the most part, my approach, and I approach the same way as the bench, I'm colorblind. I don't approach things and I don't look at things and saying, I'm going to be doing something differently because somebody is of a certain race or ethnicity. I think if we do that, we are in peril. There's a reason why Lady Justice has the blindfold on, because justice needs to be blind. Now, does that not mean that we aren't cognizant of the numbers and that they may be skewed? Absolutely we are. Are we always taking a look at what we're doing and saying, are we part of the problem? And we should be. But we can't do on an individual case do something differently because of the race or ethnicity of that individual. This is one of those solutions that we could all have a long debate as to the reasons why there may be disparities. Whether it is because of policies in which government has done since the 1960s, whether it's because of the education system, the changes in the education system, whether it's because we aren't doing enough to make sure that young people of color have alternatives to what's in front of them. Whether it may be, there's a whole myriad of things that go into that equation, and the court system is certainly part of that, but in no way will ever be the solution to that question.
Harry Bodine, former member. In a former life, I reported for the Oregonian, and decades ago, maybe, Michael McElliott was the presiding judge in Washington County. And there's a lot of whining among his fellow judges about he was a slave driver, just, you know, made him work, 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 work. And so my question to you is, you're the presiding judge. How did you get chosen for that? How long is the term? And what precisely does a presiding judge do for he can order the other judges around? Or maybe.
I think I got chosen because I was standing there and everybody else took a step back. No, it's a weird process in which it happens. The Chief Justice sends out a letter to each of the judges. The judges put in who they think it should be and whether that person's willing to do it, and then there's a vote. And the Chief Justice takes a look at those numbers and says, here's who it will be. And for whatever good graces, he decided that I was the appropriate person for this particular year, and then it's up for election again for this next term. I love the fact that you mentioned Judge McGill. I'm actually in his position. When he retired, I had the honor of taking over his position. And I can see why folks thought he was a slave driver, but he also did an amazing, when he came in, the civil stuff was really out of whack, and he did an amazing job in cleaning that civil stuff up. And he did it not only when he was PJ, he really did it when Judge Hernandez was the PJ as well. He was just an amazing, amazing man. He really was. I loved him. I thought he was great as a judge. I'll just say that about him. I just thought he was a great guy. As far as what we do, really our job is kind of one, the face of the organization. So we have to come out in front of good folks like you and talk to you all about what we're doing and be that sort of face of the organization. We have to do a lot of administrative things. Unfortunately, I don't get to do as much trials as I used to. I love doing trials. I love being a trial attorney, and I love doing trials as a judge. You don't get to do as many of those because we have to do a lot more administrative stuff. And then, of course, we sign to other judges the trials. We kind of have a process in which on Fridays we do what's called case assignment, which we make decisions as to what trials are going to go out the next week and who they're going to go in front of. And so as a presiding judge, I make those decisions as to who's going to get particular cases. We also make assignments as to the type of caseload that we'll have. You know, for example, a judge like Keith Raines, who's our chief family law judge, is presiding judge. You decide that he will be the chief family law judge and that he's on that family law team. So those are kind of the things that we do. Oh, does that help to? Yeah. I think I got both your questions, and I think those are how we got there and what we do.
John Hutzler, former member. I'd like to hear your reaction to the death stories from, what were they, several months ago when Washington County set a record for the incarceration of material witnesses in Oregon, and whether you feel that justice was served by those incarcerations in that case.
So first of all, how it came about.
And, I'm sorry, and I guess whether the courts could have done more to...
I'll answer that question first. The courts could not have done more, and in fact, I'm pretty proud of what we did do. I assume we're talking about Judge Letourneau's case in which, so it was a kind of factually, if folks aren't aware, it was a situation in which a son was accused of murder. Father was a material witness being held. We had information regarding the murder and information that happened after the murder. The father refused to, what?
Allegedly had him.
Well, it's been proven now, so.
I thought he was released without.
He talked to the police about the information that he has. So I don't get into games of allegedly sort of stuff. You know, we have our process and it works, and I think it worked really well in this particular case. And the father had given opportunities, things that quite frankly were not legally probably appropriate. For example, you can't do depositions in criminal cases, and yet Judge Letourneau tried to provide a form for the father to come in and give testimony, to give that information, to put it on the record, and he refused to do it. And so the statutes allowed for that to take place. What I think is why I'm really proud, and Judge Letourneau took it upon himself to contact the legislature during this last legislative session, have them change the law to allow in these types of situations so that deposition can take place, so we can have that information, so we don't have to hold that person. The justice system is what it is, and the justice system worked appropriately how it was supposed to be done in this bigger case, so that means justice occurred. People may not like, again, it's that Orson Welles, people in good luck, bad luck, or may not like how it occurred, but if that's the way the system is set up, and that went that process, and justice was served.
Jim Cape, four member. Last month, there were some news articles that some Washington County judges were complaining that some other county judges were working far fewer hours per year and always had lots of excuses. So is judges' work attendance a valid civic issue? And is it sexist to question why some county judges work far fewer hours per year and always have lots of excuses? Thank you.
The second question will be the easier one to answer. I don't think it has anything to do with the sexual orientation of a person or the gender of a person. I don't see that. I don't read an article. Maybe I get in trouble all the time because, and I apologize, like the gentleman before was a former Oregonian person. I can't tell you how many times either my wife or my kids or staff at work say, did you read the article? And my answer is no. I'm not a big press guy. I really don't read press that often. I really don't care what's being said in the press for the most part. I just don't. My information is kind of centered around what I'm doing in the courthouse, baseball with my kids, softball with my kids and what's going on with their schoolwork. And that's kind of where my life is sort of centered. So I don't read a lot of or do a lot. I don't know the article that came out about different judges complaining about each other in the sense of the workloads that they're doing. So I don't know if I can specifically answer that. I can answer the question, is it a civic issue as to whether or not judges would be showing up and doing their job? Yeah, absolutely. You know, we're elected officials, number one. Secondly, we're being paid to do a job, and obviously that's under a contract that we're going to show up, we're going to do our job, and we're going to be there to do our job. And we should be showing up and doing our job. So in that sense, absolutely, if people aren't showing up to work, shame on them. They should be showing up to work and doing their job. And if they're going to accept their check, especially, if they want to turn back parts of their check because they're not earning it, well, that's up to them. But absolutely, we should be showing up. We should be doing, giving taxpayers everything that they have asked of us. I don't know about the gender issue as to whether or not I know about the article, so I don't want to comment on the article if I haven't read it.
Does that help to, did I get
pretty much what you're after? Okay.
John Blackman, forum member. Thank you so much for your presentation. It was very valuable. I have a question. I know judges have a certain discretion in sentencing or fines. This would require legislation, but I just wonder what your reaction would be to fines in relation to the income of the person in question by statutes.
So Or one of those is an easier one because the when it comes to court appointed attorneys and having folks pay back court appointed attorneys, we're already by statute is we're required to make a finding that they have the ability to pay, or we can impose that. There are certain types of fines. If you're right, it would take a legislature changing certain laws because otherwise it's mandatory. For example, on DUIs, there's no discretion on the court to make a determination of whether somebody has the ability to pay that fine or required to impose that fine. So in that sense, I think it would, you know, would benefit the court to be able to make those types of determinations. I was
thinking about the opposite end of the spectrum. Someone that is immensely wealthy can pay a $1,500 fine. They pay that much for cigars.
Those would be some good cigars, which I'd like to join them with. I don't know so much. It's a great question. I don't know if it's ever been presented in the sense of, should we be asking the income of certain people and imposing on them a higher amount of a fine because they are wealthier? I guess my response to that would be, I have a problem with that. I have a problem with punishing somebody for being successful. And I think that somebody does has worked really hard and they've earned their money, and or their parents worked hard and earned their money and they have, they're wealthy. I don't know if I think it's right for us to punish them for being successful and being wealthy. I think we should be taking a look at everybody and saying, what's the appropriate amount of a fine for that individual? And that's what I said. To the degree that the legislature gave us the opportunity to say, you make a good amount of money, so your fine should be $1,500. Great, we should be able to do it. But if you don't make, you know, you don't make a sizable amount of money, your fine can be reduced or something. You're giving me a look like I didn't quite answer your question, maybe I didn't quite understand it.
No, but the impact is quite different from one person to the next of a dollar amount of a fine.
Absolutely it is. I don't disagree with you on that, but I'm saying that we shouldn't be punishing somebody for being successful. And that's just kind of, I guess that's where one of my core beliefs is. Should do that. Yes, sir.
I'm Nick Long, forum member. You mentioned various processes that we're engaged in the courts. My question is, what processes have the courts established to curb or control prosecutorial misconduct?
This is an easy question for me because I don't see prosecutorial misconduct happening out there. And maybe it's because I'm gonna go a couple caveats here. Number one, anything that I'm saying here that is directly regarding to OJD and the presentation is, I'm not speaking for OJD, I'm speaking for myself, make sure that's clear. And secondly, I was a prosecutor in Washington County before I became a judge. And so I think Bob Herman does an excellent job of watching over his troops. And so I don't see, any prosecutorial misconduct. And if it happened and I did see it, there would certainly be a sanction for doing that. And I think maybe that's why it doesn't happen. Now, there's a difference between prosecutorial misconduct and prosecutorial discretion. And sometimes we have a lot of folks that have, you know, issues with they believe the state has too much discretion in charging decisions and in sentencing types of decisions, and that would be a whole different topic. I don't want to put words in your mouth if that's what you meant, but I'll answer that question if you want me to.
Overcharging.
And that's more of an
and hiding evidence from the opposition.
I don't see our folks hiding evidence because it's their bar card, it's their livelihood. If they get caught doing that, then there'd be sanctions for that, and there'd be bar sanctions for doing that. Now, that doesn't mean that either a police officer doesn't file a report or doesn't whatever, and then they get it late or they do whatever, but I think they do a very good job of handing over discovery information. As far as their ability to make charging decisions, and I think that's more of the discretion that they have. Yeah, certainly they have a lot of discretion in making decisions as a type of charges. That's one of the beauties of our new system that we've talked about here is if you overcharge your case and we go to trial, we're going to make the decisions. We've taken it away from the prosecutors at a certain point to negotiate with people. We're saying, no, we'll make the call. If you've overcharged your case, we'll take care of that in the sense of our sentences and those type of things. To the degree that we can. There's still a system out there. It's still set up the way it is, But to the degree we have, we've taken more control of that away from them and said, look, once we get past a certain point, we're going to be handling and making decisions on sentences.
Thank you,
Judge. That's up to you.
Calvin Williams, board member, and thanks so much for the information provided for us. My question deals from the state level more, and that would deal with the Attorney General's office. So they make rules a lot of times, and I'm sure that you probably enforce those rules that they hand out. But do you have other interactions with the Attorney General's office as to cases that go on? Or
we do. I mean, they represent the state anytime the state is sued. They represent the state in those things, but they're just treated as any other type of litigant in that type of case. They're just one of the parties, and we deal with them as being a party. We see them in civil cases a lot, but they're just, again, one of the parties.
Okay. Thank you.
We have not run out of questions, but we have run out of time. So if you have a few moments, can do great. Yep. Then I will relinquish the mic back to you in just a moment. But I need to officially close today's session and advise people that Spencer Ehrman, a board member who is booking speakers, is doing such a fantastic job. Guess who's coming next week? Our district attorney and our sheriff to talk about the public services levy, which I suggest is somewhat relevant to what we're talking about here today. Ladies and gentlemen, once again, thank you so much. We'll see you next week. And we're closed for the day and open for questions.
Thank you. Thank you all for having me.
It's been a while since I've been at the forum. However, you struck on a couple of things that I needed to ask questions about. Courthouse. You know, our courthouse is old. We have courtrooms that were originally designed by the old district court. And we have buildings built next to that building that are much newer. Of course, I remember one of them was the new jail at the time when I first started practicing, and now we have another utilization. What effort is being made to talk to the county about doing a replacement for that courthouse? Certainly Multnomah County is doing that. So, I mean, where does that discussion come from? Does it come from our local judges, or does it come from chief judge? How is that going to work in order to get the county to start getting serious about replacing an ancient courthouse that I care a lot because of the courtrooms, but still, the thing is that we need to have a safe place to do that and have the ability to produce justice even in the middle of a terrible time.
So we're very fortunate in the county in which we live in. There is a lot of cooperation that goes on between all the different types of government here. And there continues to be a discussion on a new courthouse. The county just decided and just finished building a new courtroom for us, which is beautiful. They put great technology in that courtroom, which is fantastic. It was on them. They did so without even waiting. In the past, it's been, we will give you a new courtroom when you get assigned a new judge, and the legislature says we'll give you a new judge when they build you a new courtroom. And this time around, the county said we're not going to wait. We know it's needed, and we're going to build one. They were fortunate to have them. There's always ongoing discussions. Now, is there plans that have been drawn? Is there capital that's been assigned to it? No. It is, for lack of a better term, pipe dream at this point in time. But it's certainly something that we continue to talk about. We all know that if the earthquake comes, we're going to have the decision will be made for us. That's just what's going to happen. It's not a safe building, I agree. It's old. It's parts of it weren't built to be used as courtrooms, even though we made them into courtrooms. And we are going to outgrow, no different than when we outgrew the jail, to the jail that I originally showed, we're going to outgrow the courthouse. Again, the population between just 2025, if it continues to grow at the rate in which people believe it will, and certainly by 2050, that decision is going to have to be a new court, because we're going to have likely 20 judges to take care of, if not more, to take care of the work that will be done. Because by 2025, I think the estimate is, I think it's 800,000 is what the population is supposed to be. And so we're certainly going to have a lot more judges, and in this courtroom will know why. You can't kick the DA's office out and the probation and still have enough room to get it done. And it's just unsafe anyways. It's going to get more unsafe the longer and the older that it gets, and as more as the foundation settles. So it's always ongoing discussions. Each presiding judge has been part of working with the county and going over the discussions. It's certainly nothing in the works right now, and I don't see anything, quite frankly, to be in the works, quite frankly, in the foreseeable future.
My second part of that question, sorry, is the issue is who would folks like the members of the forum would want to go speak to a county official about this subject in terms of that? Who would be the best place for them to go to express their opinions about the need of the courthouse?
So Bob Davis is the current person who's in charge of Washington County as far as a non-elected official, and of course any of the commissioners or Chair Dyke would be folks. They're aware of it, but certainly they'd be the people to chat to and say what's on their horizon for a new courthouse or the expansion of the current one. I really do think it's going to be a new courthouse, and the idea of where is it going to be built and how is it going to be built. They're aware of it. But those would be the folks I would send or be the folks to chat with. But letting you know at the same point in time, they're great. We communicate. I meet with Bob Davis twice a month. We chat about what's going on in Washington County. The commissioners have been great and open, and if we have questions, we can chat. But those would be the folks that I think would be the best people to talk to about it.
Thank you.
Yeah. Anybody else? No? Again, thank you all very, very much for having me.
Thanks again. Thanks for staying with us.